When Luke and I were invited to read this evening, we had an idea. We wrote some poems together a couple of years ago and performed them around the time that we read them just once. And we said, Janet, we've got some collaborative poems, would it be okay to do them together? So we're going to read like half of some poems that we wrote together, and that will bring us up to the end of the first portion. So can I ask you to join me in welcoming me?
Matt, we didn't decide who was going to start. Shall I read the title and you read the first line? Yeah. I no longer remember who wrote any of these lines, so that's kind of okay. They'll be all mixed in, it's fine. The first poem is called Where's Maisie?
If it sounds like a Luke Kennard line.
Yeah, that was from my Matt, and vice versa, essentially.
I'm sorry, you said it's something to say to that.
No, we can do it again, we can lead in. Just. So, Where's Maisie is the name of a series of children's picture books, which you may be familiar with, which I was reading quite a lot to my two-year-old at the time. This is when we were brainstorming titles. It was one of the things that was very much on my mind. So yeah, I'll read the title and that you leap straight in there. Where's Maisie?
Under an actual real-life cardboard flap I had especially installed over a lint-in. Please help me to pull the giant tab which protrudes from my living room window, and we will make sure she's okay.
She is taking or leading a seminar on speculative teaching methods, wearing a diving helmet, and not one of the students who are also wearing diving helmets know who the seminar leader is, and she will be out of office until the 16th of the 4th, 2017.
Gap year.
She is in the interdepartmental stationery cupboard, removing the rubbers from the ends of the pencils.
Shining brightly in a blanket sky, i.e. dead.
She is in the orchard in her hammock with a paperback copy of the 39 Steps.
Heaven and hell are states rather than locations, and I get goosebumps in a bad way when the translation specifies the heavens rather than heaven, seeing as we've been to the heavens and there wasn't anything there, and the world effectively ended 1800 years ago, which is to say, dead.
She is in the parachute above the wintry moors, humming tunelessly to herself.
Letters entry the Holy Spirit that she finds rest, where the light of his countenance shineth, where there is neither sighing nor sorrow, but life unending.
At the 8 items or fewer checkout, having that argument we all sometimes have, where she's explaining that her 12 boxes of Jaffa Cakes, 3 jars of Nutella, and 2 twin packs of spearmint gum, the 3 regular bottles of white wine, and the 2 tubs of chocolate caramel ice cream each constitutes 1 item.
She's in the kitchen making you a fucking sandwich.
By the motorway slip road, in her coat in the drizzle, holding a sheet of cardboard on which, in firm blue letters, she has misspelled the word Norwich.
She's backstage trying to make small talk.
You know when you go to a stranger's house and pretend to be their child and try to get involved with their rituals and habits, like weak instant coffee or hanging horse brasses on the walls, etc., but something feels understandably askew? Well, that's where Maisie is when she's with you.
So they're all lists, in case you haven't noticed, they are all lists. This one's called Why I Quit the Band.
Because I wrote all of the songs, but whenever we were in the studio, Lawrence just made up a load of songs on the spot and said that we had to record those ones instead.
My hitherto unassailable enthusiasm for the harpsichord gave way that autumn to an equally unassailable enthusiasm for tomato ketchup.
We were just getting in more and more PR guys until eventually the PR guys outnumbered us, and I realised when I saw the dust on the headstocks, the torn cones of the amplifiers, the first ghost of rust on the snare drum, that we were just managing a small independent PR firm.
Imbalance of the humours. I had always been the one who brought the black bile, so when they got Howard in, I was basically redundant.
Replaced by machines.
That prick, Lawrence.
It always seemed okay when, depending on the successes of our regular sets of electric punk blues, we'd huddle backstage with our rolling rocks and pretzels, trying to gauge whether the continuing cheers and hooting warranted our returning for an a cappella rendition of Keep It Tight and Keep It Sweet. But that year we got to the point of having played 126 gigs, every one of which ended in an encore. The whole encore thing just seemed like too much of a con.
Before the final mix, Lawrence deleted and re-recorded every single one of the 16 tracks of sound so that on our seminal record, it's just Lawrence playing everything. When I realised this, I went back in time, married Lawrence's mother, so that at least I had his father and I had some staging proceedings.
This one's called List with Two Items.
Clarinet repair utensils.
Pregnancy test.
Side effects.
Loss of sex drive, appetite, temper, sense of proportion, way, mother, wallet, self, dignity, face, weight, but not face weight, which will balloon astoundingly, also mind and battle.
The inability to say anything whatsoever without fitting the words of the sentence to the melody of Where Do You Go To, My Lovely?
Where are you? The supermarket. What's that in your hand? Garden shears. And your trolley is full of soap. And what's that man doing? Remonstrating. Can you understand what he's saying? No. Are there sirens? I think so. What happened in the last aisle? I'm not sure. Shit.
An enthusiasm for table tennis.
Byronism leading to extreme Byronism.
Simultaneous burping, coughing, gasping, yawning, sneezing, sighing, raspberry blowing.
Spouse may take on other forms. You'll notice more earwigs than usual and may even get into debt. Also xenophobia.
A slow erosion of the bones coupled with a concurrent strengthening of the muscles resulting in an increased dexterity in activities such as juggling, frisbee, ping pong and cat's cradle, generally followed by a sudden irresistible fatigue.
You may become quite petulant. Missionary zeal can occur along with compulsive redecorating of your house.
The Emmental effect.
May, in some extreme cases, cause your condition to dominate your life. This one's called Advice for Weightlifters.
Think of the weight as the thing God was thinking of on the force of earth. Think of the weight as the thing God was thinking of on the first morning of creation. Think of your strength as all the other things he focused his mind on avoiding thinking of.
Often beginner weightlifters are told to begin with small weights and work their way up gradually, but this just leads to mediocrity, amateurism, and coasting. I always tell my weightlifting students to start by lifting another weightlifter over their heads, and then to work their weight down until they appreciate how difficult it is to lift even a china cup off a saucer. That's when we start reading Deleuze and Guattari, and once we've read their complete works and their principal detractors, only then can we start lifting competitively.
Think of the weight as the ruse by which the Coca-Cola company has, since anyone can remember, been able to hang on to the rumour that there are secret ingredients, or a secret recipe, or a secret initiation ceremony for the workers of its production plant. Think of your strength as that voice that won't quit nagging, but it's just burnt sugar, but it's just carbonated water.
Consider the worker ant carrying a tiny fragment of leaf on its back. What a fucking pussy.
Think of the weight as your strength. Think of your strength as the weight.
I know that you want advice on how to win weightlifting contests and how to get medals and awards in weightlifting, but that's not what I'm here to teach you. The only reason I won my award was that there happened to be one judge on a panel of six who liked my style of weightlifting. For the others, I was too much of an experimental weightlifter. It was luck, basically. You have to be weightlifting in the first place because you love it.
Think of the weight as the reason that, unlike wrestlers, weightlifters go by their given names. Emily Godley, Ali Jallard, Ben Watson. Think of your strength as the reason that, unlike weightlifters, wrestlers are likely to go by their stage names. Cat Weasel, Iron Fist, The Fish Cake.
Diet. Lots of people get distracted by this and waste valuable weightlifting time counting calories and writing meal plans. My one rule is this: eat really heavy things. Never pass up the opportunity to pick up something really heavy, even if you are only going to eat it.
Think of the weight as the idea behind the ideas behind things. Think of your strength as a thing of which there is no idea.
Weightlifter's block doesn't exist. If you feel uninspired, just pick something up, anything, it doesn't matter what.
Think of your weight as the needle. Think of your strength as the record. Now put them. We've come to the final one before the break, but we knew you were going to like go away and bitch about us, so we're going to end with preemptive bad reviews of this project.
It is always sad to see a writer indulging himself, him, for it is usually a he, but how much worse it is to see two writers indulging themselves and each other.
Although the stated aim is not to produce poems as such, but through placing the emphasis on the collaborative process, to explore the possibilities of literary practice in a way which hybridises the précis, the questionnaire and the jacket blurb, these are, when it all comes down to it, just poems after all.
Many of the lists outstay their welcome. In fact, the whole book outstays its welcome. Point of fact, I don't recall inviting it in the first place.
Proof positive that in the age of the internet, the printed collection has become a completely redundant form.
I'm sure these were enjoyable to write, just as having a drink with your mates is enjoyable. I would never presume to make it a spectator sport.
If the reason behind the failure of the entire creative writing project in UK universities has been that, as all creative work has to be dissected by its author in an accompanying reflective piece, the overwhelming tendency is to produce work which is easily describable. It perhaps comes as no surprise that a book of lists should do exactly what it says on the spine. Love said.
In the end, it amounts to a bid for total irrelevance, shooting for irreverence, but bouncing off the backboard and into the face of whoever they're trying to impress. One feels embarrassed to have ever taken them seriously.
Nietzsche's shopping lists were published because he was Nietzsche.
What is Stevens' assertion that poetry must resist the intelligence almost successfully is here replaced by the notion that creative cynicism must replace any regard for literary merit. Thank you.